conjunction with the Hillstrom Museum of Art's current exhibition, Grant Wood's Lithographs, a Regionalist Vision Set in Stone. And that exhibit, along with a concurrent one titled Art Inspiring Art, George Bellows' Sunset Shady Valley, is on view at the museum through November 8th. And I should mention that the museum will be open until 7 p.m. this evening so that those wishing to view the exhibit following this lecture can do so. Today's lecture is presented by the Hillstrom Museum of Art with support from the Lefler Lecture Series Fund. The Herbert P. and Mary Jane Lefler Lecture Series was established in 1993 by Mary Jane Lefler in memory of her husband Herbert, with the intent of bringing outside speakers to campus to meet with classes and address the community, thereby enriching the academic experience here and carrying on the Lefler family's tradition of pursuing truth and integrity through curiosity, inquiry, discussion, teaching, and learning. I'm paraphrasing from the official description of the Lefler series. This lecture is also supported with funds by the Gender, Women, and Sexuality Studies programs at the college, a multidisciplinary program that leads students to interrogate the social meanings of femininity, masculinity, sexual behavior, and desire as integral to the ways that groups and individuals construct their identities within and across a variety of historical, social, and cultural contexts. I'd like to thank Martin Lang, director of the Gender, Women, and Sexuality Studies Program, and his colleagues at the program for their support, as well as thanking Betsy Byers, chair of the Lefler Lecture Series, and her fellow Lefler committee members. Our distinguished guest lecturer today is Dr. R. Tripp Evans, who is a professor of art history at Wheaton College in Norton, Massachusetts, where he serves as the Mary L. Heuser Chair in the Arts. Dr. Evans has taught at Wheaton since 1997. His BA degree from the University of Virginia was in architectural history and French literature, and his MA and PhD, both in art history, were from Yale University. Dr. Evans has lectured widely, including at the American Folk Museum, Folk Art Museum in New York, the Memorial Art Gallery at the University of Rochester, at the University of Kansas and the University of Toronto, and for the Grant Wood Art Festival in the artist's hometown of Anamosa, Iowa. Evans serves on a variety of boards, including the National Advisory Board for the Grant Wood Art Colony, headquartered at the University of Iowa, and the Steering Committee for the University of Virginia's Jeffersonian Grounds Initiative, and the Executive Board for Yale University's Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. Evans is the author of numerous articles and books. His earliest book, published in 2004 and based on his Yale dissertation, is Romancing the Maya, Mexican Antiquity in the American Imagination, 1820 to 1925. And he is currently working on two additional book projects titled, tentatively titled, 6 Acres of Providence and The Importance of Being Furnished, 3 Yankee Bachelors at Home, which both focus on New England cultural heritage. Evans is also the author of the meticulously researched 2010 book, Grant Wood, A Life, described in the New York Times in a review as absorbing and thoughtful. It was the winner of the Marfield Prize, the National Award for Arts Writing, and was a finalist for both the Lambda Literary Award and the Randy Schultz Award for Gay Nonfiction. This biographical study is a crucial addition to the literature on regionalist artist Grant Wood, familiar to many as the creator of the famous and iconic painting American Gothic, and other images that consider and often extol the Western milieu. Evans' book is the most important of a handful of studies that, unlike the earlier studies on Wood, carefully consider the artist's life and work in light of his sexuality, a subject that effectively had been glossed over by earlier scholars. Our exhibit at the Hillstrom Museum of Arts, of the Hillstrom Museum of Arts full collection of all 19 of Grant Wood's lithographs, was conceived not only as a way to debut that collection, but also to introduce this new approach to the artist. And Tripp Evans will speak about Grant Wood's lithographs, his biography, and his sexuality. Now, before I turn over the podium, I want to mention that we will be heading over to the museum after the question and answer session at the end of this lecture. And Tripp has indicated that he'll be happy to chat and entertain questions at the exhibit, and also that he'll be happy to autograph any copies of his book. Now please join me in welcoming our Lefler lecturer, Dr. Tripp Evans.
Thank you. Thanks for the very warm welcome. Can everybody hear me? Great. It's such a treat to be here, and I have to say, what a rare opportunity it is to see all 19 of Wood's lithographs together. It's such a treat to be able to see them together. And you know, like any great museum show, one thing that you often regret when the show is down is that there's no real record. And here, there's a fantastic record in the wonderful catalog that accompanies it, which is really a tremendous scholarly resource. So I really hand it to you for putting together this wonderful catalog. I learned a lot, actually, reading it myself, so hats off. I thought it would be appropriate to start with an image of Grant Wood at his lithographic stone in 1937. In 1937, Wood was really a household name in American art. He was, of course, known as the creator of the most iconic American painting still, American Gothic, 7 years earlier, and was really heralded as a leader of the so-called American scene or regionalist movement at this point. Tonight, I will be looking at his work for Associated American Artists, his work as a printmaker between 1937 and 1941, with references to some of his paintings as well, where they sort of help illuminate the way that he was thinking, I think, as a printmaker. There were literal cross lines in his work, the kind of technique that he used for his printmaking, but there were also lines that he crossed in terms of historical models, medium, and his negotiation of kind of public and private themes. The second part of the lecture will be focused on Sultry Night, his 1938 lithograph. A close reading of this is a kind of distillation of many of the themes that we see in some of his other prints. This print, too, crossed a few lines and was the center of probably one of the greatest controversies that Grant Wood had to weather during his professional career. It is, to all Grant Wood scholars, really kind of the most interesting of his prints, and so it bears a much closer reading. And it is today also at the heart of kind of a great art historical mystery that I'll unfold for you all a little bit at the end. It's been really fun, and unfortunately unfolded after the book came out, but I've been pursuing it nonetheless. So I feel like I'm, you know, required by law to show American Gothic at some point within the first five slides of any American Gothic lecture, or any Grant Wood lecture, I should say. Wood's shift from painting to lithography was in some ways as radical as his earlier shift in 1929-30 from his much earlier impressionist style, which you see here on the left, 1924. And a lot of people don't realize that he was really a very talented impressionist painter for most of the 1920s, to the mature style that we know of his work, that sort of hard-edged, Northern Renaissance-inspired, kind of very flat and graphic type of form that we see in American Gothic, which was, of course, the painting that catapulted him to fame. You also see, in addition to his change in style here, his change in theme that also affects the subject matter of prints that we'll be looking at, which is the people and places of his childhood, essentially. When Wood comes back to Cedar Rapids in 1930, after a good decade of traveling to European cities and other sort of urban centers in the U.S., it was a permanent return. In fact, his autobiography that was never completed was called Return from Bohemia. The idea was that he was leaving the Bohemian world behind for Cedar Rapids. So this was a huge, sort of divide in the road for him, stylistically, thematically, in terms of sort of how he defined himself. It also meant that he returned to his sister Nan, the model in American Gothic, and his mother Hattie. The three of them not only lived together until he was in his mid-40s, but they shared a single room above a carriage house at a funeral parlor. So it was a little bit of an Adams family kind of setup where Nan and Hattie and Wood all shared his living and studio space together. The front door of the studio, by the way, was a 19th century coffin lid that you had to sort of open to get in. It was part of his sense of humor about where they were living. But the shift from painting to prints that happens with his association with Associated American Artists happens in conjunction with three other major shifts in his life, and you might even call them crises, professional, personal, and artistic. So in 1934, Grant Wood joins the faculty of the University of Iowa. And this leads also to a wide range of public lecturing. He becomes a much more public figure, which was both great for him as a sort of, you know, the profile of his career as an artist, but it also had real dangers as well. The sort of better known he became, the closer often interests began to circle into his personal life. And as a closeted man, it was increasingly difficult for him at the University of Iowa, where his department chair eventually tried to get him, you know, out of the department through a kind of not-so-quiet whispering campaign in the early 1940s. So this was a big shift for him, going from painter to painter and academic. It was a huge period of personal upheaval for him as well in the mid-1930s. So, In 1935, in 1 year, Nan moves out west with her husband, Ed Graham. She was in fact married while she was living with her mother in Grant. Her husband was in a sanatorium for many of those years. And also in 1935, Wood's beloved mother, Hattie, goes through an extended illness and dies in 1935, and she had really been his rock. He had lived with Hattie, as I said, his whole life until the age of 45. And right around this time period in 1935, as his mother is going through her final illness, Grant Wood surprised everybody by marrying this woman. This is Sarah Sherman Maxson, who he marries not long after his mother dies. And to folks in Cedar Rapids, she bore a sort of unsettling resemblance to Hattie Wood, his mother, and began what was a rather troubled marriage. They were married for about 3 years. So in addition to all of these sort of personal upheavals in his life, Sarah insists that they leave Cedar Rapids and move permanently to Iowa City. So all of his family connections, all of his connections to the town really of his boyhood and growing up years, were severed in 1935. We also see a real, sort of difficult period for him in terms of painting. This was a period that would really hit kind of a dry spell. And not just a dry spell, but the paintings that he was completing were not always necessarily being critically received as well as his earlier works. So spring turning, you're seeing here from 1936, is really the one major painting that he creates between 1936 and 1939. And this is for a painter who was rather productive early in the 30s. We see at the beginning of his association with printmaking a real dry spell for painting. And he turns from painting partly too because of the way that landscapes like this one were critically received. From the very beginning, Wood's highly mannered and almost kind of abstracted landscapes had never been, as well received as, say, his portraits or his genre scenes. And there are a lot of reasons for that. People thought they were too abstract. They thought they were too mannered. In fact, Wood himself said, I know that I have these landscape mannerisms and I'm having a hell of a time getting rid of them. Underlying this was a subtle and sometimes not so subtle suggestion that they were eroticized or sensual, that they appeared to represent bodily forms. And when you read Wood's return for his manuscript for his autobiography, Return from Bohemia, you see the way that he describes the land. We don't have enough time for me to go into this, but he is always describing the Iowa farmland as masculine and muscular, and there's no Mother Earth in his autobiography. It is always a notion of a kind of a raw and exposed male body. So you often do see these sort of muscular forms in these landscapes, and critics like Henry McBride were a little unsettled by this. So this was one review of Spring Turning, who saw in it a satire. He thinks that he's sort of, you know, poking fun at the seriousness of farming. Wood's satire goes too far, I think. That is making fun of nature. You can't do that to anything as serious as spring plowing. Something will surely happen to Grant Wood soon. Wait and see. It was a veiled threat of, if you don't stop, you know, with these, you know, landscapes, you know, we kind of know what kind of a person you are. So when Associated American Artists approached Grant Wood initially in 1934 to join their stable of artists who were creating prints for a much wider kind of democratic public, it was really kind of a salvation for Wood. He was in this terrible dry spell. He did not have a predictable income from his painting. Suddenly he was associated with a very wonderful stable of fellow artists, including, of course, his fellow regionalists. You can see up the top, John Stuart Curry and Thomas Park Benton. Associated American Artists had been founded in 1934 by Reeves Lewenthal and Maurice Lederman. And their business model was to get a stable together of well-known artists. And a lot of these are American scene or regionalist artists, folks who were invested in rural imagery. Not all, but a great majority of them. These prints were then sort of marketed by mail through catalogs. They're also sold in department stores. As you can see, they were sold for only $5 each. They are considerably more valuable today, but they were considered a sort of democratic, economic way for a collecting public in the height of the Depression could, you know, sort of have original access to original works of art. So these were struck in editions of 250. And again, you could order them through mail, you could buy them at the department store. There were even advertisements in places like Reader's Digest and Time Magazine where you could pick these up. And they really became sort of widely collected. So it was a democratic kind of approach to selling original art. For Wood, it was also a way out, almost even emotionally, in terms of turning to a new medium. And here's a quote from his good friend Hazel Brown, a good friend of his from Cedar Rapids. In describing his early printmaking, she said, "Wood began carving stone with a concentration and determination seen in people who are working off a mad. He literally dug into the stone as if his life and peace of mind depended upon it." In a lot of ways, it really did in this period. He was searching for a new creative outlet. Now, both Wood and Associated American Artists had in mind a sort of business model that we see in Currier and Ives. Currier and Ives, the sort of well-known 19th century printmakers, were actually founded exactly 100 years before Associated American Artists, so 1834. They marketed, mass-marketed, cheaply produced, hand-tinted, prints for between 5 cents and $2, and they were marketed in much the same way. Associated American Artists is thinking about this kind of a democratic model. They're also sort of tapping into notions of nostalgic rural imagery of America. And Wood himself was fascinated by Currier and Ives, and we'll see that in some of his prints. In fact, he did help one of his early patrons in the 1920s assemble his own collection of original Currier and Ives prints. So they kind of run as a theme underneath some of the imagery that we've seen today. Now, I'm going to give you just a brief overview of the 19 prints, and some of them I'm going to come back to in greater detail. But in 1937, 3 years after sort of initially signing the original agreement with Associated American Artists, Grant Wood produces these two images, The Planting Group and Seed Time and the Harvest, that kind of thematically linked planting and seed time. And they're typical of the kinds of images that reflect his memories of childhood. In particular, his fond memories of the Antioch County School, the one room schoolhouse that he had attended as a child, and the harvest scenes that he would have known up to the age of 10 on the farm. So after his father's death when he was 10, when Wood was 10, they moved into Cedar Rapids in 1901. And much of his post-1930 work, I argue in his biography, is, and others have said as well, is a sort of an attempt to recapture a perceived golden age before the death of his father. So many of the scenes that we'll be seeing about kind of farm life are memories of a boyhood in the 1890s, really, rather than the 1930s. So the following year, he doubles his production for Associated American Artists with four images, three rural scenes, including July 15th, which is, you know, we're seeing those troubling mannerisms once again in his landscapes. January, which I'll come back to, Sultry Night, we'll hear an awful lot about later, and Honorary Degree, which is, I'll mention again as well, as one of his sort of more humorous prints. 1939, he produces eight prints, including more rural imagery, and I'll come back to some of these, as well as another satirical print. 1940, only two, these very moody images of February and approaching storm. In the sort of run of images, these are, I think, some of two of the more charged ones. And then in his final year of production for Associated American Artists, he produced these three works, which are all very different in a way. March, I think, is probably one of his most dynamic and kind of abstract prints that he does for Associated American Artists. And December Afternoon is probably, I think, his most old-fashioned, drawing straight from Courier Empires, especially the sled. The image on the bottom is a reprisal of a work that, an illustration called General Practitioner, that he'd done for a 1937 edition of Main Street. So he was sort of going back to an earlier theme. So in thinking about Wood as a printmaker, I want to show you these two, and I'm sorry that they're a little bit pixelated at this size. I mean, any time you take something that tiny and blow it up this big, you lose a little bit. But you all are able to see in these details what a consummate and meticulous draftsman Wood was, with this medium that involved using a lithographic sort of greasy, crayon to draw on the stones, or to draw and then to transfer. And you can see he uses a variety of techniques, including the kind of hatching that you see in tree planting group, and that little sort of stippling effect, that really lovely stippling effect in Honorary Degree. You can also see, in addition to the crossed hatching and crossed lines, the lovely way that he kind of bleeds into the border often. It's really nice to sort of see these edges. And when you go to the show, I really want you to sort of pay attention to those edges, because the grass sometimes just sort of bleeds right into the border in a really kind of lovely way. So as a printmaker, he is the sort of consummate draftsman. And this approach also reflects that shift I talked about earlier from his much more painterly style to his much more graphic, linear, sort of hard edge style. This affects the way that he works as a printmaker. And the way that he worked as a painter, it feels like he was already a born printmaker even before he got started, because he really didn't work in this medium at all until the mid-30s. But if you look at that spring turning detail, this little figure group, these two horses with the plowing figure, it's a tiny detail in the painting. It's really small. But you can see the almost kind of maddeningly tiny little brush strokes that he used to sort of build up the canvas. This is one of the reasons why he produced so little sometimes in the 1930s. His paintings took forever to complete. And in fact, they show his admiration for a tempera painting from the Northern Renaissance. Because when you paint in tempera, the medium kind of requires you to do a lot of cross-hatching because the paint dries so quickly. He's working in oil here, but it's almost as if he's working in tempera, using these tiny little hatched strokes. In drawings like Plowing on Sunday, you can see, rather than a sort of soft line, a real attention to cross-hatching, again, the same kind of approach that he's using as a draftsman and as a printmaker. And then the last drawing I'll show you, sort of in conjunction with these prints, is this part of his study for a really grand painting called Dinner for Threshers. in which he's like watercolor over colored pencil here. And I can tell you, when you get right up on top of this drawing, it is almost impossible to see the strokes of the colored pencil. It is so seamless. And I think that that's sort of what sort of translated so beautifully also to his prints. What you also see here, too, is that often Grant Wood made drawings like these as independent works of art in their own right. They weren't considered necessarily preparatory drawings. They were a sort of glorious reiteration of a work in a different medium. So his ability to kind of move from one medium to another really stood him in good stead when he took on this work with Associated American Artists. Now, prints allowed Wood to do a number of new things in his work. Obviously he was, as I've been saying, already a great draftsman. One of the things that the prints allowed him to do was to explore serial imagery, sort of a notion of putting together different images under a theme. And one of the most obvious ones that comes to mind when you look at his prints is what appears to have been an early attempt, an unfinished attempt, to do the 12 calendar, the 12 months of the calendar. So he only got really, in terms of the single named ones, he only got as far as March. We can sort of count July 15th and December afternoon within this series. But certainly this is something that Currier and Ives was interested in doing as well, and he would have known this. So, for example, that image that I showed you at the beginning of Homestead in Winter, it was actually part of a four-part series. You had Homestead in Spring, American Homestead in Summer, Winter, Autumn. And this serial notion of showing sort of the place over time, I think was very appealing to Wood, and prints allowed him to do that. The most clearly serial work that he did, and this is four separate prints, they're sort of jammed together in this image, but they're actually four separate prints, which you have fruits, vegetables, tame flowers, and wildflowers in the corner. These sold for a little bit more. These were $10 rather than $5 because they were hand-colored. And they were hand-tinted not by just anyone, but they were hand-tinted by his sister Nan and her husband Ed. Who were contracted at $100 a month to hand tint all 250 of these. It is not just an interesting sort of serial image that looks directly to Currier and Ives. In fact, Currier and Ives did similar types of botanicals where you would look at sort of fruits or flowers in that way. But it's also a good indication of the way in which Wood kind of insistently gendered inanimate objects and things in his paintings, including, as we've seen, landscapes. So the sort of rounded, feminized fruit has a sort of masculine counterpart in these much more sort of elongated and phallic forms in vegetables. The same can be sort of tame flowers and wildflowers. The tame flowers are sort of made to look like a sort of feminine Victorian print, and the wildflowers, sort of more rugged and raw. We see this kind of, masculine and feminine kind of balance going on often in his work. As we'll see, his prints were no exception. So the other thing that prints allowed Wood to do was to go back to his painting and mine it again for kind of new material. So, tree planting group, in that initial pair of prints, is really a reprisal of his Arbor Day from 1932. There's not a one-to-one correspondence here, it's the same genre scene, but it's allowed him to sort of go back to his work and find, fruitful creativity from his own earlier work. And this worked in reverse as well. His prints began to allow him to think about new forms of painting, sometimes in a one-to-one comparison. So his January, which comes out in 1938, leads to the 1940-41 painting of January. And remember that when you're making a print, it's in reverse, which is why we see sort of the reverse of the image when he finally creates the painted version. So prints were beginning to allow him to sort of look back at his own work and use it in new and interesting ways. He also, in addition to revisiting imagery, he revisited themes in a way. So his Daughters of Revolution, which was, you know, caused a sort of, you know, mini scandal with the Daughters of the American Revolution, who believed rightly that they were being satirized here, has its male equivalent. You know, again, that sort of, you know, the sort of gender parody that he's giving to these satires in his Shrine Quartet, where he portrays a kind of humorous image, again, of these sort of pillars of small town life placed in a setting that makes them look, you know, kind of lightly ridiculous. But he loves these figures too. He's not entirely sort of poking fun at them. But in both cases, the punchline is in the background. So whether it's Leutze's heroic image of Washington crossing the Delaware, and these are the daughters of that revolution, or the shadows cast across the sort of fake image of Egypt behind the Shriners. Another avenue that prints allowed him to explore was the exploration, because of the immediacy of print, images of contemporaries and recent events, and sometimes inside jokes, and this is a good example of that, an honorary degree. We're seeing a self-portrait of Wood at the center, and there are a couple of really lovely caricatures in this show that I hope you all will get a good look at, one from 1925 and one from a little bit later on. But there he is, sort of caricaturing himself, having received, in 1936, an honorary degree of letters from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He's kind of poking fun at himself. And the guys on either side are actually colleagues of his at the University of Iowa. Norman Forster, who's one of the founders of the Iowa Writers Workshop, and Carl Seashore there on the right. So this is, you know, a way for him to create a genre scene. It's autobiographical. The print medium has kind of allowed him to do something much more quick and contemporary that a grand painting would have allowed him to do. You also see him poking fun at his own career in the sense that that enormous Gothic window above is the reference, of course, to American Gothic. And in fact, he jokingly referred to this as scholastic Gothic. So when it came to Sultry Night, which was published in 1938, we are looking at a print that in many ways continues, you know, what we've been talking about, this idea of revisiting subject matter and themes that he had clearly been interested in his painting. We see contemporary reference here. We see autobiographical reference. And you also, and I'll walk you through it when we get there, you can also see his love of serial imagery within a single image. And I'll explain what I mean by that in just a moment. So in this image, we're seeing a farmer bathing under a cascading sort of tub of water pulled from a horse trough in a very lonely, deserted landscape. This is clearly not like all of the other prints in a lot of ways. And it really stunned audiences when it was first produced. The naturalism of the nude figure took many aback. The fact that it was a very sort of unapologetic frontal nude was a bit of a shock. And as one critic said about this, Wood has failed to shadow and shrink the male parts as tradition requires. So we wanted sort of some kind of artistic fig leaf to sort of shield our eyes. The fact that he has kind of a farmer's tan makes him even look more nude than he would normally have looked, because we really get the sense we're looking at a real body. And his eyes are closed, so he's unaware of us seeing his body. So there's a lot here that made people very uncomfortable. Wood explained himself the scene from his childhood that inspired this. He said, in my boyhood, no farms had tile and chromium bathrooms, and after a long day in the dust of the fields, after the chores were done, we used to go down to the horse tank with a pail. The sun took the chill off the top layer of water, and we would dip up pails full and drench ourselves. This is the memory of a 9 to 10-year-old boy. Not someone who would normally have come across a farmhand at midnight, you know, bathing. So there's a disconnect in some ways between Wood's memory and the scene that he's sort of creating here. So the controversy that it inspired led the U.S. Post Office to ban the distribution of this image in the US mail. It was deemed an example of pornography. And it couldn't be included in the Associated American Artists catalogs, although, of course, female nudes were fine, you know, in those catalogs, but this was trouble. And Associated American Artists themselves cut the print run from 250 down to 100. And so these were, it was a drastically reduced print run, and really one of the most kind of unsettling controversies that Grant Wood had to undergo during his artistic career. He said very little about it, but as you'll see in a moment, he took it, his reaction to it was almost a violent one. Before I get to that, let me just say that as a theme, male bathers can be found throughout Wood's work early on and throughout this period. Here we're looking at his new bather from 1920. This is a figure that's on Indian Creek, and there's actually a painting of Indian Creek in the show called The Crick, I think, from 1924. So when you see that, it's the same creek. This is in Cedar Rapids. This is one of his illustrations from Farm on the Hill, a children's book. So this notion of a male bathing figure, we can see multiple examples of in his work. There was a planned painting that Wood wanted to create beginning in 1935. He started planning for it, called The Bath, 1880. He never even got really to preliminary sketching for it, as far as we know. But this was to be a painting showing a farmer in red, old-fashioned red flannel underwear and bathing in his kitchen on a Saturday night. He began his kind of research for the painting by advertising in newspapers for authentic flannels from the 1890s. This was going to be sort of the start of his process. And that's about as far as he got, because newspapers who, gossip columnists and journalists often wrote about Wood in this very tongue-in-cheek way about, our bachelor artist, the unmarried Grant Wood. There were always sort of little digs at him about his kind of bachelor status. And this they could not let go, the fact that he was advertising for men's underwear in the newspaper. The Kansas City Star characterized the artist's search as, quote, the fulfillment of an old desire. Whereas the Minneapolis Tribune claimed, Wood is throwing into his quest a good deal of flaming ardor. So there were these little digs at him about, making, coded references to his rumored sexuality. And he dropped the project. He had gotten the flannels and was able to use, sort of recycle them, at least the idea of them, in a much different image in his print series, The Midnight Alarm, in which we can see a model wearing the long sought-after long johns that got used for this. But The Bath, 1880, was never to be. So if The Bath, 1880, had caused a bit of controversy, some playful and maybe a little bit hurtful teasing for Wood, the drawing that he completed in 1937 seems to really kind of court controversy. This is in the year right before he does Sultry Night. Saturday Night Bath, as far as we know, was never intended for public display. We now know who did own it. I'll explain that a little bit later on. It is a large-scale drawing. It's about a little over 2 feet high. And it's the closest predecessor that we have to his working out the kind of composition for Sultry Night. In some ways, it is far more eroticized than Sultry Night, the fact that there are two figures here, and that one is actively disrobing. It's not an entirely finished sketch. It's not clear where he was going to go in terms of maybe doing a painted version of it. But if you look at the two together, you can see that, we've gone from two figures to one, the barn and the horses are gone. The focus has really become shifted onto just the solitary figure, which both makes it less eroticized and in some ways more. You're really confronted with his body in a way that you aren't in Saturday Night Bath, largely because it is a frontal nude. And he also changes the title in a way that I think courted a little bit of controversy itself.
Saturday night bath sounds harmless enough. Sultry night evokes, all sorts of things, heat, desire, and the fact that it is a sort of semi-voyeuristic scene in the middle of the night. All of these things are why the post office had been deemed it to be too hot tomato. And critics of Wood's work who really wanted to support him and protect him from this controversy, both in 1938 and much later, up through the 1970s and 80s, defended this image as a metaphor, saying that Wood really isn't showing us an individual farmer, he's showing us an American Apollo. This is a sort of classicized notion of an island farmer. Others have said that it is the American Adam, that this is all about sort of the notion of going back to the purity of the farm. I partly buy the idea that this is a metaphor, but I have argued in my analysis of this that he's tapping into something much more local to Iowa culture, and that is the figure of King Corn. The South had King Cotton, and Iowa had King Corn, complete with a palace. There were many corn palaces, but this was the first corn palace in Sioux City, Iowa, in which a god would be crowned. King Corn and his consort Demeter would hold court. So there was this popular imagery around the notion of a man kind of embodying the corn, the most staple crop of Iowa at the time and now as well. And that association between the male body and corn was something that was just a part of Wood's upbringing. So here you can see the Atchison Corn Festival Carnival, this young boy sort of dressed as a corn stalk. And if you look at John Stewart Curry's portrait of Chris Christensen, who was head of the agriculture department at the University of Wisconsin, he places him in a cornfield, partly because of what he's teaching, but all of the men in the cornfield with their fluttering ties are made to sort of look like living embodiments of the corn stalks that they're passing through. And in fact, Curry does something much more explicit in that conflation of male form and the corn stalk with his Kansas cornfield from 1936. And Wood and Curry knew one another at this point, and Wood certainly knew this painting. When Curry described this painting, he said, "It is a self-portrait in vegetal guise." If it is a self-portrait, it is also a nude self-portrait, because there is a single ear of corn about halfway up that has a very sort of strange fleshy pink color. This isn't just the slog. And this sort of notion of the sort of phallic nature of corn, again, is cooked into the metaphors about the potency of this crop and the power of the land. That's why I said Wood often talked about the land in really masculine terms. Wood himself, and I'm so glad to see this in the show, for his autobiography, when he was figuring out sort of illustrations for Return from Bohemia, includes this also very powerful and potent-looking ear of corn, that is in many ways connected again to his feelings about corn and masculine power, seeing fully in line with some of his other illustrations of this as well, where we often see these sort of hardy men sort of carrying giant baskets of corn. It's as if male potency is being kind of knocked over the head with it a little bit in terms of thinking about corn in this way. It was also part of the language of Wood's upbringing. So the whole idea of calling someone corn-fed or husky, a young boy who was growing up sometimes was called, you would describe him as tasseling out, which is what a mature corn plant does. So all of this sort of imagery and sort of local sense of male bodies and corn are what we are partly seeing in Sultry Night. And I feel as when I look at his work, that we're beginning to see a moment in Sultry Night where that fleshy kind of sensual landscape style for which he becomes so well known, in this kind of Pygmalion moment, sort of the lamb becomes flesh in this really arresting image. And I have to say, there are a couple of others. You'll have to bear with me because I really got into porn when I was writing this book. I have a few other things about sort of the way that the farmer is depicted here that really, especially for an Iowa audience, would have evoked an idea of King Horn. The farmer's knobby and awkward joints, the spray that appears above his head and his nested genitals below, all mimic the essential features of a mature corn stalk. So all of that kind of legginess. And the sort of bushy character of the corn silks. Beyond these more recognizable elements, Sultanite's figure also exhibits corn-like qualities that would have been familiar only to a farming audience. There was a widespread folk belief in Wood's childhood that held that corn grew primarily at night and only came alive, under the cover of moonlight. Another feature Midwesterns would have associated with this plant is its reputation for prodigious sweating in hot weather. In the hottest days of July, a fully grown corn plant can transpire up to 19 pounds of water in a single day. So Wood's figure embodies all of these traits, the corn stalk's awkward strain toward the moon, its unslakable thirst, and even its sweaty pungency. He's a fantasy of King Corn stripped of his robes. So there's a metaphorical element that you can't escape, and that notion of the landscape becoming man, I find fascinating. I can't take credit for this, but I love it. Someone pointed out to me once, and I'll show you a sort of graphic of it, that this tree in the distance becomes almost part of a serial imagery in which you see the tree far off, the tree here, and then suddenly the upstanding figure of the man, almost as if this natural element of the landscape has moved into our field of vision and become human. In fact, remember, this would have been reversed for him. I think it works even better thinking of it moving, sort of dynamically this way, so that this is kind of the final metamorphosis. And that metamorphosis happens, and it's pictorially so beautiful how he does it, with that impact of the water. So the water hits the chest, and these lines actually follow perfectly along the crop's sight lines in this print. So, the water hits him, and it's sort of this magical moment. And it's also, it's eroticized, it's a metaphor about, the power of this farmland, and something that I think we know Wood was very proud of before having put together. Given the controversy that it inspired, Wood followed the next year with an image that in many ways kind of cleans up any controversial elements about the kind of fertility or potency of Iowa farmland with his Fertility from 1939. But even here, we're seeing a battalion of, once again, one-eared corn, one-eared corn stalks going off the back, and then, of course, still the very masculine and potent form of that silo rising up out of the field. If you look at Saturday Night Bath and Sultry Night, you can see the real DNA for this print. The barn has been sort of transposed over here, and the silo figure in many ways sort of takes the place of the farmer at Sultry Night. American Gothic is not far behind. You see the American Gothic house in the background. So again, sort of a self-reference here. So, if Wood intended Sultry Night in this, I think what he often considered the best of his prints, certainly historians of his work often point to it as the best that he accomplished in this series, it is also, in its immediacy, very clearly a real person. And Wood always used models for his work, even for really sort of abstracted figures. So, for me, as a biographer, when I was looking at this, I was interested in sort of metaphorical dimension, but I thought, it's gotta be someone he knew. It has to have been someone who was modeling for him in the 1930s. And the theory that I think bears the strongest evidence for the model, given the timing of this, is Eric Knight, who's later the author of Lassie Come Home. He came to Iowa in 1937. He met Grant Wood through Norman Forster, who we saw an honorary degree. Knight was at the Iowa Writers' Workshop, and he lived with Wood in the summers. Sarah, Wood's wife at this point, had moved on. Their marriage had really begun to fall apart in the late 30s, and Eric Knight moved in, was there in the summers. So the timing is right. Eric Knight was himself a kind of amateur artist, and we know that Norman Forster, who introduced the two of them, was also serving as a model for Wood. If you look at certain images of Eric Knight, the very dark hair, he was incredibly lanky, he had these very long hands, and there's, if you take a look at those fingers in Sultry Night, I've seen pictures of Eric Knight playing the piano. He's got that same sort of knobby appearance to his hands. So I think in terms of the physical resemblance, I think there's a real case to be made here. Also the fact that he was a summer roommate of Wood's, summer tenant of his, speaks to the theme of a hot summer night that you see here. But for me, the most irresistible connection is the pun that Wood would have adored. Sultry night with a K. It's exactly the kind of thing Wood loved doing. He loved visual puns, he loved punning in his titles, and this would have been the ultimate inside joke of Sultry Night. I'm sticking with it. That's my theory about who this is. Now, beyond the question of metaphor and the identity of the model, this still leaves the question, and left for me the question, unfinished when my book came out, of whatever happened to the painted version. There was a painted version of this work that was intended to be sort of Wood's comeback. Let me just read to you about his unveiling of this. So Wood, as he did with January, which we saw before, and working on Sultry Night and working on a major oil painting, he really believed was going to kind of revive his reputation as a painter. Wood's first biographer, Garwood, in the 1940s, writes, Grant invited more than 50 people to his house, this is in Iowa City, for the unveiling of the painting. This was really kind of unusual for him. This wasn't standard practice. It stood high on a rack over the sideboard, and both his dining room and his living room were full of men and women that night. Strange to say, it was the men rather than the women who were embarrassed. There was a palpable silence that met this painting that I think was probably more humiliating for Wood even than the post office painting. This was really meant to be his kind of comeback painting. Clearly, the painting was finished at this point. So as an art historian, I've always been curious, what happened to this painting. Nan tells us, and this much I did know, Nan tells us the painting suffered a rude fate, whether as a result of the postal office ban, I do not know. Grant was bothered by the thought that some detractor might try to create evil where there was none. He sawed off the portion that portrayed the new farmhand and burned it. More than half the painting remained. Wood never destroyed his work. I mean, this is an extraordinary act of violence. I mean, I think it says everything, in Nan's words at least, about just how much this controversy really hit home for him. So when I was finishing the book, I wondered where on earth this sawed off remainder of the painting could be. If it still existed at all, because all I knew was that the painting had been purchased by someone named Wellwood Nesbitt. Now, Nesbitt is important as a patron in Wood's career. He was a friend, a collector. It turns out he also owned Saturday Night Bath, which I showed you earlier, so we actually had that as well. He was an exact contemporary of Wood's. And he knew Wood through his wife. So Genevieve Runkle, later Nesbitt, was in this tiny graduating class of Washington High School in 1910. That's Grant Wood, a very handsome teenager in the center. So Genevieve marries Wellwood Nesbitt in 1918, and they start collecting decorative arts made by Grant Wood, a lot of his impressionist paintings. And in fact, they even ended up creating a house based on one of his paintings. So this is one of Wood's impressionist paintings from the 20s that the Nesbitts owned. And then for their house in Maple Bluff, Wisconsin, they actually had it reproduced from the painting. So they were pretty serious about, you know, sort of their commitment to wood. But the painting fragment that we know only from Wood's first biographer that went to Nesbitt had never been illustrated. It had been mentioned by scholars, but nobody really seemed to have any idea whether it still existed, how long the Nesbitt family held on to it. And at one point, I was told point blank that it was lost, that this to stop looking for it. So in the spring of 2012, imagine my surprise when I was sent an auction catalog from Jackson's Auctions in Cedar Falls, Iowa, with a letter that still cracks me up, because it was written to me personally as Wood's biographer, saying, "We really believe that this would be an important addition to your collection. So we are willing to offer you a sultry night account for a cool $1.5 million. Obviously, I was out of the market for this, but I could not have been more stunned. I immediately called about three or four of the titles that I knew to say, I can't believe it, it's resurfaced. How did this come about? The story as it unfolded does go back to the Nesbitt family. So here are the Nesbitt family with their daughters. Martha, circled here, the youngest of them, she inherited the painting when her father died in 1953, so it became her painting. When Jim Dennis was writing the first monograph on Grant Wood, he became very close to many people in Grant Wood's world, including Nan Wood writing. And Jim Dennis and Martha developed a very close friendship, and it becomes a little unclear whether this painting fragment was given to Jim Dennis as a gift, or whether he was sort of keeping it for safekeeping. At any rate, Jim Dennis had this painting for many, many years. Jim Dennis was the one who told me it was not trackable. And he was the seller of the painting at auction. So I have to say, I won't get too much into the battle that ensued with Martha and Jim. It's back in Martha's hands now. But I will say that Sue Taylor is a wonderful Grant Wood scholar who was just as floored as I was. She flew in from Portland, Oregon. I flew in from Providence, Rhode Island. We met in the middle of the country on this pilgrimage. We have to see Sultry Night with cattle, a name that cracked us up as well. But it was really just such a lovely surprise to see. There were many things about it that for us were, as I said, a surprise. And there were also elements of it that led to a new mystery that I'll just briefly touch on. So it's a lovely silvery landscape. As far as we know, it's one of the only nighttime scenes that Grant Wood completed. The whole painting must have been extraordinary. The strange shape that you see here shows the violence that was done to the painting. It was intended to have an arched top, just like Saturday Night Bath. So we've had this lovely kind of arched top, almost like an altarpiece. This particular shape was very important to Grant Wood. He only used it for paintings that had sort of deep personal kind of connection with him. He used it for a painting called Victorian Survival in 1931, which was based on a tintype that was on a Tilly, and also for a sort of veiled self-portrait called Adolescence that he created in 1941. Those are the only three examples of him using this very special kind of shape. And it does make for an odd shape in the final version. Now the cattle that are blinking out at us from back here, obviously this is a posthumous title that was put on this, are obviously not center stage, but they're an intriguing sort of nod to one of Wood's favorite painters. Edward Hicks, the great folk painter, who often included these little sort of sweet, naive images of cows. And in fact, Wood had used this before. This was a book jacket that he did for a novel called In Tragic Life from 1934, in which he included those little cows at the top. This is one of the most surrealist compositions Wood ever did. This is a coming-of-age story of a young farm boy who's struggling with his sexuality. Wood took the commission, and created this sort of floating surrealist image of Bibles and sort of American Gothic-like people and the floating cows of above,
which show up in Sultry Night with cattle. Now, once the painting was recovered and was put back on loan at the Chazen Museum at the University of Wisconsin, they had a tiny but very potent little show of the print, the painting, and a very important document that Martha had saved along with the painting that, again, was a, kind of a gold mine for Grant Wood scholars. It is a letter from July 1938 that Wood wrote to John O'Connor. He was head of the Carnegie International, a juried exhibition. Scholars had always known that Sultry Night was not, that the print was banned, but there was also a rumor that the painting had been sent to a major juried show and had been sent back, had been refused by the jury. We'd never been able to sort of figure out if that story was true or not, but at the, you know, in hearing about it, you think, can you imagine someone of Wood's powers and his popularity and fame being refused from a juried show? This letter proves it. It is sent to John O'Connor from the Carnegie International, and we know that it was not in the Carnegie International's show for 1938, and we found out from someone else that it had been absolutely refused, partly because of its subject matter. The letter also explains that someone named Stanley Razor was lined up to buy the complete painting, and you realize that the rejection of the first patron, who didn't want the cut down version, and the rejection of the juried show must have been a sort of double blow to Wood. When Sue Taylor and I were out tracking down the painting, Sue, and I have to give her full credit for this, Sue found Wood's still living framer at 100 years old. This is Willis Guthrie, in a picture taken on that trip in 2012. He was a painter as well. This is one of his paintings. You can see the Grant Wood kind of influence. This is his painting, Oasis, from 1941. We sat down and talked with Willis Guthrie because he knew that he had started to work for Wood as a framer and as a sort of errand person in the studio right around the time that Sultry Night, the oil went out. And he confirmed for us, in totally lucid at 100, he said, my first job for Mr. Wood was to unpack the crate holding Sultry Night after it had been rejected. And he said, I told Mr. Wood, this cracked me, I told Mr. Wood all he had to do was paint more water in it. Just put a lot of water and then just send it back with a big cascade of water, which cracked us up. But he said that it really kind of undid Wood. And it was Willis who also made that arched frame, that sort of odd frame for Wellwood Nesbitt, who stepped in to buy it. So the final mystery now, and as I said, I'll just touch on this briefly, the final mystery to me that really got Sue and me thinking when we were out there is the very odd way in which the oil painting was cropped. Now, if we look at the print as a kind of stand-in for the painting, because it does appear that there was kind of a one-to-one correspondence between the print and the painting, this is where you would cut a painting to save the composition, right? You would be able to sort of bring it over a little bit. He certainly could have painted over the any sort of hangover from the figure. But if you look back at the oil painting, you can see it sort of cuts right through the water tank. So rather than this sort of more logical place to cut it, this is where it was cut. And there is a world of difference between this kind of a fragment and this kind of a fragment. The fragment on the left is a fragment that you cut off, you know, in a fury and burn. This is something that is very carefully centered and very, you know, preserved. And if you look at the back, too, the sort of notion of him kind of sawing away at this in a fury is belied by the surgical edge that you see on it. That's the cropped edge over here. Absolutely professionally done on the back. And there's also the question of underpainting, right? So if the figure, and sort of cut out, see where those little red lines are? you would have seen kind of some form of underpainting from the figure or the bucket. And if you look at the edge of the painting, it's as clean as a whistle. There's no real evidence. I'm going to get right on of underpainting of any figure that's been kind of cut out. So all of this to me points to the belief that, at least in Wood's own life, that this was a carefully saved fragment. We know that Wood saved even arbitrary fragments from paintings that he cropped. He would give these fragments to, you know, friends or to people who worked in his studio. So the last piece of evidence that I'll present and wrap up with is another painting, another male nude that Wood created, the Académie Julienne in Paris in 1924, was one of his most prized possessions. And I think that it gives us evidence in terms of thinking about how and why he might have saved this fragment from Sultry Night. The Spotted Man, this is another one of his drawings. It's spotted because it's a pointless technique, but it's also spotted because we're looking at him. He's making a joke about the Spotted Man. So this was one of only three paintings that Wood refused to sell during his lifetime. His portrait of Nan, his self-portrait, and this painting were the three kind of most important paintings to him. He kept this painting in his studio, kept it on display in his studio, wherever he was, Clear Lake, Iowa City, Cedar Rapids. And this too caused a problem for Nan later on, who wanted to sort of defend her brother. So Nan says, oh, everyone says, you know, his biographer said that, you know, he always had it displayed in the studio. He never displayed it in the studio. He was a little ashamed of this. I mean, we always knew that he kept it in the dresser that he kept in the studio. There's the dresser. The dresser still exists. Here's the problem. 32x14 doesn't even fit. There's no way it would fit in. But Nan is insistent that he kept hidden, away from view, this male nude in the dresser. Guess what would fit
in the dresser?
That's about the size of the fragment. And, you know, it's clearly, you know, something that I think Wood would have cherished. It's certainly a much more accomplished work even than Spotted Man. And I always tell my students, this is how I figured out how big it was. By looking at the figuring out that, never say art historians don't need that. So this is my scribble down at the chase and thinking like, how big is this thing? We have to know exactly how big it is. So it probably looks a little bit like this, with a little bit of an arched top. And I said at the chasen, you know, how lovely it would be one day, and at the Hillstrom as well, to have, you know, an exhibition that brings together Wood's prints, the story of this, you know, painting and its fragment. I'm still looking for it. I have some theories about where we might look. But today, you know, I feel like this one print as a case study gives us a sense of the value of this new medium for Wood, the way in which, you know, it crossed all kinds of lines for him, both in terms of his reputation and in terms of his medium, and really illustrates this extraordinary chapter in his work and life, as do, I think, so many of his prints. And for an art historian and biographer, there's nothing better. So thank you all very much. I have got a little bit of time.
The reason why I believe that you know, the sort of argument against that is that Nan was more aware than anyone of the monetary value of Wood's work. She was the executor of his estate, and she lived off of his work basically for the rest of her life. So for her to destroy something so accomplished, I would be, you know, reluctant to believe that she would do that. Whether it may have gone, you know, my strongest possibility is that I think that the Nesbitt family, they still have it. And they're just, you know, being a little bit tight-lipped about it. I'm still working on that.
Especially because that other person denied the existence of this art.
Welcome to word scholarship. Sometimes ordaining, you know. I mean, it's people get, you know, territorial. It was worded in a way that it wasn't an outright. I was thrown off the trail. It was not an outright, lie at that point.
Was he involved in CCC? You know, they had artists go around the country and do all kinds of paintings and.
I don't know about CCC. Do you know about CCC? What are the initials stand for? Do
you know?
Oh, okay. No, I don't know. I don't know the answer to that.
He was head of the Iowa division of WPA for a time.
Yeah, he was very much connected to the WPA. Yeah. So it wouldn't surprise me.
I just want to comment. I think your arguments are very persuasive and utterly fascinating. And also, I was born in Sioux City, so I appreciate your comments. I think they make sense about the importance.
Well, and that's an example of when you have to sort of get back to the mindset of who was looking at this and how they would have thought about it.
Do you have a theory about why that looks like a barren field behind the man?
You know, for me, I think it allows him to stand in metaphorically by sort of not identifying what the crop is. There is something in that field. It's planted. It's so abstract, you can't really get a sense of what it is. But I feel like it almost wouldn't work if you saw corn behind you as well. You know, sort of like, I think it abstracts that background and then he sort of becomes the standard. It's a very lonely looking, like, I think that tree in the background makes it even lonelier.
Your comment about his style and his photography, the cross-hatching and stippling, made me wonder, did he ever experiment with etching or engraving? Or do you associate those methods more?
Not that I know of. You've been immersed in this stuff for much more than I have.
I think he did a small amount of investigation of engraving, but he really didn't pursue it at all. And he hired other printmakers for the Stone City Art Colony, so he certainly wasn't practicing it.
But you're right, I do sort of recall that.
I'm thinking longingly of those 250 prints that existed of all of those AAA prints that he made. Do we have any idea where those are? Are they well documented that they're in museums? Are most of them in private hands that we don't know?
They show up with some regularity on the Antiques Roadshow. You actually see them say, "Oh, this belonged to my grandfather." But I don't know that there's an inventory.
No, I don't think anybody's attempted to identify where it all went. And there are a number of collections that have them, but there's probably as many as 15 or 20 of any one that would be known where they're located. But the others is like all clear. And a lot of them probably do not survive because they're sort of inexpensive, and then as fame became eclipsed, people probably didn't keep them as often as you would think.
And museums didn't even keep them often as long as. Sultry Night is obviously the rarest since there was a limited impression. And very hard to get a hold of. And I'm delighted I tracked one down for Wheaton. Wheaton now has one in its collection. That had been deaccessioned by Grinnell in the 1970s, when Wood's reputation was really, actually falling out. So
it's my alma
mater. I love Grinnell. I'm not asking Grinnell. No, but they've got a great collection. But to me that speaks to even, really, sort of committed institutions to collecting American art, not. You know, maybe these prints are not as valuable. They are. I think they are now. I know they are. We had to pay for it. We're the college student. Yep.
Was Mr. Knight a swimmer? Because this man looks like he had a swimsuit on. The old male swimsuit with the sleeveless top.
Oh.
Because there is a tan line on his legs. So
it's hard to tell if that's just like where the shadow starts again, but you're right. I don't know. I don't know if Knight was a swimmer. Wood was an enthusiastic swimmer and an enthusiastic skinny dipper. All these stories about his antics, growing up and as a grown man.
It looks like a male old-fashioned male one-piece swimsuit yeah. worn by this man.
And I'm sure they would, you know, Associated American artists would love for him to draw them.
Do you have an idea? I have a two-part question.
Yeah.
Do you have an idea of the numerical output of this artist? I mean, was it a huge body of work?
No. I mean, there are these 19 prints, but in terms of Wood's paintings, up until like 1929, there's a pretty sizable output because he's doing impressionist studies and some very finished impressionist paintings. In fact, when modern paintings come on the market today, they're almost inevitably his 1920s sort of impressionist paintings. From 1929 onward, it was such an excruciatingly slow process for him to create these paintings that, you know, in the early, I don't have an exact number, but in the early 30s, you know, in his most prolific years, he's maybe creating maybe half a dozen paintings in like 31 and 32. And then there's, you know, this whole period, 3 years from one. Between 36 and 39, there's really only about four major paintings that he does. He said, you know, this is a process that was like sweating blood for me.
Well then, two questions then. Why did he do that? and second of all, are there records of other lost paintings? Are there, you know, if he lost this key painting, if there were others that were lost,
we knew about this one. I don't know of any other paintings from his mature period that we're still looking for. And we were having this conversation actually just before about the fact that, you know, inevitably there are impressionist paintings of his that come up and people say, maybe it's his, maybe it's not his, we're not quite sure, because he did so many in the teens and 20s. These works were so difficult to produce and were surrounded by so much hype. Grant Wood has a new painting out that we've been able to keep track of them with this exception.
What was it in his personality, since you know this artist, that would cause him to work in this fashion?
First, he got extravagant praise. I mean, this was the style that he hit upon. Everyone said, he's our new American painter. So it was partly that. But I think it was partly, I mean, he really hit on a style that was deeply satisfying to him. He changed his style, I didn't get into it today, but he changed his style after having an epiphany in Germany. And studying some of the old masters of Northern Renaissance paintings and also the Pinakothek in Munich. And there's this story of, you know, the scales fell from his eyes and he thought, like, that's not real pain. So as excruciating as it was for him, I think it was deeply satisfying for him as a craftsman and as a painter to sort of create these meticulously built up canvases. And I think it was also difficult for him kind of psychologically returning to the 1890s, this period before his father's death, that he both wanted to revisit, but it was not easy. I think that's part of what he means when he says, I was sweating blood when I created these paintings. But like a lot of artists, you know, it's suffering makes me.
Is the autobiography available? Is it published, or how does it?
I don't know if it's available online.
No,
it's just a typescript. It's just a pile of typescript.
There is a microfilm copy of it in the archives of the American Art that Stiles can be very threatened to get.
Oh, and James Dennis published. He did work with the publisher.
He published his that and the Revolt Against the Seder and parts of Returning from Bohemia, but it's it's available to scholars. The thing that I really wanted to make available to scholars, which was my favorite bombshell discovery for this book, was I found Sarah Maxson's manuscript of her autobiography, his wife, that nobody knew she'd even written such a novel. And when I was finishing the book, my editor said, do an epilogue and catch the reader up on like what happens to everyone. And nobody ever mentioned Sarah after their marriage is over. So I'm literally sort of just trolling the internet at one point to try to find like genealogies or obituaries, find out when she died.
And I see some Civil War era papers that belong to her estate in Washington State. So I called up the bookstore and I said, well, this was from Sarah Maxson's estate. Do you have any idea when she died? Or she died in her town? I said, you should talk to Edmar Collier. He was her landlord. He's always wandering around town with Sarah's letters and Sarah's manuscripts and all of Sarah's reminiscences about her marriage to Wood. And nobody, you know, nobody wants to read this stuff. I do. And I got on the next plane much faster than I got on the plane for Sultry Night. And it was, oh man, this is some amazing stuff. And what an interesting marriage it was. And what an interesting character she is. I'm trying to get Bartholomew's daughter down to the papers to give them to the Archives of American Art. Because she was connected to Jerome Kern and Broadway and lots of really interesting figures.
What was the definite age for two
people? She looked a lot older. She was, she claimed that they were childhood sweethearts. But she was almost a decade older. She looked a lot older than he because she had, white hair when they married. And she was a grandmother at the time. I mean, people were really, we thought that he got teased for the underwear advertisement. All of these teasing headlines about his marriage, which were really in some ways kind of mean-spirited, bachelor marries, now they can laugh at us all, that kind of thing when it came out, which was, I think, kind of, awful for them both. But she was a good bit older.
Is Grant Wood the most famous Iowa artist?
Yes.
Yes.
I would say, yeah, absolutely. In fact, he's on the back of the Iowa Quarter. Harvard is on the back. And in fact, they include his name on the quarter. And he's the only American artist that I know on American currency whose name is actually on American currency. I mean, he is the sainted son.
One other thing that I think might be worth mentioning to address one of those questions is that in return to Bohemia, the manuscript, he wrote a fair amount, but it was all about early part of his life. He barely gets beyond the childhood. So there's nothing, we have to kind of extrapolate from what he says about that time to his mature period, and we don't get tidbits about, well, Sarah said blah, blah, blah. None of that.
Right, I should have mentioned that because it's very telling for biographer that he goes swimmingly along to his father's death and the manuscript ends. And I actually think it in some ways it tells us all sorts of things that we need to know about the period that he's going back to, because that period, the first 10 years of his life, becomes this endlessly, mindable field of subjects and kind of memories. But I mean, American Gothic is very much, kind of weird, veiled portrait.
Just an aside, you're mentioning favorite sons, you might say this. Carol Seashore is a graduate of this course.
She's graduated
of this college.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Class of 1891.
did you mention that in the capital?
I
must have, I'm sorry.
There's a bus on the campus.
Oh, I must have lost that, but I didn't realize that. They were great buddies of the boards. Seashore and Forster.
There's a nice document where Swedish newspaper that extols Wood and can't read it, so Seashore translates it.
Now, three Seashore brothers came to Wasika, Minnesota, and they became architects and interior designers. So if you go to the town of Wasika, you see all of these. And they translated their name from Sjostrand to Seashore. And I've written about them. So
it's the same family?
I'm wondering. No idea.
Are there any other questions? Well, thank you again.